On today's show, all the best midweek action in a week that's brought good news for Manchester United. We feature the new Wimbledon manager, Joe Kinnear. He's helped the Dons turn the corner in the last few weeks. And the story of Jim Henderson, the youngest public address announcer in the country at the tender age of 15. And Manchester City's David White is another guest. We reveal what he gets up to when he's not playing football. Good afternoon.
Hello. Oh, sorry, I'm checking my flies, sign. Not that anyone's going to notice under here, are they?
So. Well, there's no matches off today, thankfully.
No, that's incredible. Actually, the weather people have got it right again.
Yes.
Who kept saying that there'd be gales and snow and ice
Scotland,
and everything.
Supposedly.
So there's no matches off, as we should have realised.
But, James, Brighton were on to this morning. They said that their home match today against Blackburn is not all ticket.
Not all ticket. Though our producer's going.
He'll be, yes.
Our producer will. Do you know what, folks? Lord Lucan could be our producer. We wouldn't know, I'll tell you. But what a great week it's been for Essex.
Yeah.
What a great Essex. Well, yeah, great week for Essex, it always is. But for England.
Go on.
Oh, shut up, lads, will you? They're winding us up already,
yeah,
so.
And this.
But we've won the rugby, we've won the cricket. And dear old Dick Muscle won 600 grand on the Cheltenham. He'd his 80p tax on his £8 bet. And that saved him 60 grand. So, as Lester Piggott would say, pay your tax, folks.
Right. OK, well, first today, the goals that took Manchester United through to the Rumbelows League Cup final against Nottingham Forest on April the 12th, despite a spirited display from Middlesbrough in a thrilling game.
Paul Ince. Brian Robson. Webb has made a run to his left. Kicks ahead of him. McClair. Now Webb, now Lee Shaw, real chance, 1-0! He's back! Here goes Stuart Ripley. Parker trying to stick with him. Ripley is strong enough. Chance for Slaven! 5 minutes of the second half gone, and Middlesbrough are back in business. Neil Webb. McClair's there, so too's Robson. It's Giggs! That could be the one!
Well, United through, Jim, and the young Lions, Giggs and Sharp, doing the business.
But I'm having a nightmare here, Saint. My pen's run out and everything. It's a nightmare. But no, it was a great win for Manchester United. Really, stop laughing.
Well, you have to say well done Middlesbrough, who pushed them all the way.
Actually, they did do well. They were a bit unlucky because Schmeichel made a fabulous save, and had that gone in, you'd have had to have said Borough would have got there. Uh-huh. But all credit to both sides.
Sets up
great final.
Righty ho. Well, also on Wednesday, Manchester United's league title hopes were enhanced when Queen's Park Rangers inflicted a 4-1 defeat on their main challengers, Leeds. And that's where we begin a roundup of the midweek First Division action.
Here's Strachan. Batty's gone wide, and so too is Newsome here. Curling in a good cross and nodded down beautifully by Gary Speed. Leeds United go into the lead. Comes the corner. Forced in there by Les Ferdinand. Wilkins again. Allen's going in there. Lukic has lost for the moment. Bradley Allen. Only his second game of the season. And a super strike for Rangers. Les Ferdinand. Might come for Allen again. My goodness, there was nearly another break for him. And now Sinton with a shot. Andy Sinton. Now Leeds have more trouble at the back. That's a penalty, absolutely for sure. Well, it was a last-ditch challenge there by Chris White, and he might even be in serious trouble here. It's a red card for Chris White. Well, Clive Wilson scored from the spot on Saturday. He scores from the spot again. Here's Dean inside the Wednesday penalty area. He's cut the ball back, and Dane Whitehurst has scored for United. What a start for the derby, and what a start for Sheffield United. Rodgers making progress. Davison calling for it in the middle. Davison's coming for it. Oh, he must score. Bobby Davison on his debut. He's going to be Phil King. And Phil King has scored. Gannon will float it in with the left foot. It's not a bad ball. It's 3-1. Bobby Davison has glanced the second for himself and a third for United.
No surprises at Anfield, though. The last thing West Ham wanted was to go behind early on, but inside 3 minutes, Jamie Redknapp had warmed Ludek McClosco's gloves and Dean Saunders had swooped for the only goal. West Ham's big problem, goal scoring, was there for all to see after that. They're up against Arsenal this afternoon. Before Tuesday, the champions hadn't played in 2.5 weeks. It took them half an hour to get going. Then David Hillier and Anders Limpar combined to set up Ian Wright. Hillier was instrumental in Arsenal's second, dispossessing Graham Sharp, who's rather better in the other penalty area. Paul Merson couldn't miss from there. If Arsenal still harbour hopes of a place in Europe, two goals and Nottingham Forest's first league win since Boxing Day.
Charles Mitrovic beaten by his own player. Terrible misfortune. And it looked like David Smith who deflected the ball finally home. Keane. Difficult looking ball after the Coventry defenders. Still danger and Sheringham, it's gone in off the post.
At Carrow Road, 6 minutes from time, Chelsea nicked the points. Kerry Dixon's first goal in 3 months was a big boost for him and his teammates if they end up playing Norwich in the Cup semi-final. Southampton will have a say in that at Carrow Road next week, and on current form you wouldn't bet against them. Matt Letizia had one of his good nights as the Saints moved out of the bottom three and extended their unbeaten run to 10 games.
Well, they're going strong again, Southampton. You know, I did feel the other week, Jim, when I saw them that they really were better than the position. Playing tomorrow, Letizia won't, of course, be playing
in
that
which
game.
Is a shame, because he got stupidly booked, and one has to say the referee had no sense of humour because he collided with Bruce and hugged him, and yeah. And the referee took his name at Liverpool.
That was a couple of weeks ago.
Ridiculous. Yeah.
Right, now, Chrissy White, of course, can't complain when he got sent off.
No, I don't think Chris has got much of a defence there.
You rush your blood out, wasn't it? What was he doing?
And Chris Woods, well, I'm not sure. I mean, he had a bit of a dodgy time, didn't he, for Sheffield
well,
Wednesday?
Well, I was at that derby match, and Chrissy didn't have a good game. He was at fault, certainly for that goal, and made another bloomer in the second half. And it may well be, Jim, that his confidence is a little bit short.
Yeah, but I was talking to Gary Lineker on Monday, and he said that, you know, he's never let England down, and I suppose that's a fair point.
Well, he has, and we'll see what happens on Monday when he picks a team. Right, midweek action next week on ITV, by the way, is the second leg of Spurs Cup Winners' Cup quarter-final against Feyenoord on Wednesday at 8. An ITV souvenir magazine for the occasion will be on sale at the ground. Price, £2. And I think that is... You were on there, weren't you?
I think that was me in the middle there, opposite. I was trying to wrestle the cup, which must have been full of champagne at the time. So,
One of Spurs' former favourites is now in charge at Wimbledon. And since Peter Wythe left in January, the Dons have enjoyed a 7-match unbeaten run under new man Joe Kinnear. Gabriel Clark reports.
At Wimbledon, they look fondly on the achievements of managers past. Dave Bassett brought First Division football and the crazy gang spirit to Plough Lane. Bobby Gould brought back the FA Cup. Last year, both took delivery of brand new BMWs for services rendered. So don't be surprised if the new manager soon pulls up in a Rolls Royce, because Joe Kinnear's put Wimbledon back in the fast lane, just when it looked like they were heading down a one-way street to Division 2. After one win in 16 games, Peter Wythe got the sack, and Kinnear, overlooked in October, finally got his chance.
You know, it's like having a player in the reserves, and you think he has some fantastic potential, but I felt at that time he wasn't ready. And, you know, in hindsight, that was a mistake on my part. I think I made a major error on behalf of this club, and we could have suffered in a very dramatic manner, I think.
How low was morale when you took over?
Morale was on the floor. It was on the floor, and Everybody was looking for everybody. Someone had to come in and sort it out, do surgery as quick as possible.
That meant a return to the basics Wimbledon have always done so well. A penalty from John Fashion, who got them a draw in Kinnear's first match at Queen's Park Rangers. Last Saturday, Fashanu's 15th of the season made it 4 wins, 6 games unbeaten, and all but assured them of a place in the Premier.
But let's get back to the crazy antics which are going on off the field.
Something Kinnear knows all about. His teammates at Spurs remember his sense of humour as much as his 4 cup medals. At Wimbledon, the new manager's already taken his players out to a West End strip club, and building team spirit is the main reason the dressing room sounds more like Stringfellows.
People always ask me about the music in the dressing room and one thing or another. I just think it helps take pressure off players. There's a lot of nervous tension in dressing rooms. And it's a super way of everybody relaxing. Back to Dave Bassett days, Bobby Gould days, players have been handpicked to come in. There's a lot of consideration and thought gone into signing players at Wimbledon. You've got to be a certain type, but they've all turned out to be good types.
But all the fun and games aren't just confined to the players. Anyone in the boardroom at the last 7 games might be wondering why Sam Hammam suddenly disappears 10 minutes before kickoff. Well, it's because he goes back to his office to get changed. Into his cowboy boots, jeans and baseball cap. That's what he wore to Kinnear's first game at QPR, and he'll keep on dressing down if his team stay unbeaten.
These are happy days, you know, and we have to, I have to admit that, you know, we had our back up against the wall not long ago, and I'm a happy man the last few weeks.
At home to Everton on Tuesday, Wimbledon always looked like extending their unbeaten run to 7 games, but the closest they came to a goal and 3 points was when Robbie Earle just failed to connect at the far post. The acid test comes this afternoon. Leeds United are next for the new improved Crazy Gang.
The players have been magnificent. You know, I'm getting a lot of credit at this moment in time, but you're only as good as your senior pros and you're only as good as the players you got. And their response has been magnificent. And I couldn't have done anything without their help.
Not a bad start so far, anyway.
Super start, yes. Hope it continues.
An old teammate of yours, Joe?
Oh, very much an old teammate. A bit serious there, old Joe, because he's a good laugh and a long-time friend of David Mackay, of course, who
yes.
he went out to Kuwait with David. Uh-huh. Maybe he was responsible, I don't know. But I'll tell you, Joe was the manager of the last team I ever played for, Woodford Town, you
yeah.
know? Yeah, really, because We got to pre-season training and couldn't get in, and we finally actually got in. The caretaker gave us the key, got in the dressing room, and it had a notice on the board, Jim, I'm away for 3 weeks holiday, take them for pre-season training. That was Joe's first command as manager. So I've worked under Joe as manager, so I understand how he operates. Needless to say, after 3 weeks pre-season, we weren't very fit, not with me taking them anyway.
Yeah, he's moved up a bit in the world now, Joe. Good luck anyway, at Leeds today.
He's the man for the job. Yeah. He's the man for the job.
All right, well, more action for midweek now, and Clive Tursley's lower division roundup begins with Southend's visit to Blackburn. 5 games without a win now for Rovers, but they still lead the way in Division 2.
Blackburn had enough of Tuesday's game to win it in the first 20 minutes. As it was, they were 2 down in 30. Ian Benjamin somehow surviving Kevin Warren's tackle to smuggle it through to Andy Ansar. Fifth place Southend had some ground to make up after a miserable February. Suddenly they were heading forward in top gear. 2 minutes later, Richard Brown lost Dean Austin's cross, and Brett Angel capitalised expertly to tuck away his 22nd of the season. But Blackburn got one back on the stroke of half-time. Chris Price, with the aid of Roy Wegley and a Pat Scully deflection, giving them only half a mountain to climb. They reached the summit in the very last minute. Colin Hendry playing as a centre-forward, scaling the heights to leave David Speedy to hooking an equaliser that keeps Blackburn on top despite dropping 12 points out of the last 15. Kevin Keegan did Kenny Dalglish proud at Cambridge when Newcastle, led by the revived Mick Quinn, won 2-0. Gavin Peacock coached the first. That's 15 for the season for him. The second followed on just 6 minutes later, just before half-time, and arrived in the style to which Keegan's accustomed. Nice and neat. David Kelly posting Newcastle's second consecutive away win off the far post. Derby County, investing heavily in a future in the Premier League, are already counting their winnings. Their newest acquisition, Paul Kitson, set up a second-minute goal for skipper Gallant Williams against Port Vale on Wednesday. Vale, bottom of the table and without a win in 15 games, equalised soon after. John Jeffers claimed it. The deflection stopped his shot going for a throw-in. But Derby seized the initiative early in the second half, or had it handed to them. Paul Simpson's third goal in 4 games since his arrival from Oxford. All the night needed now was for Marco Gabbiadini to follow his lead, and sure enough, his 6-week wait for a goal at the baseball ground ended, and maybe ended Vale's survival hopes in the bargain. 4 wins out of 5 now for Gabby and Derby. The frayed ends of promotion nerves are there for all to see in the third division. Bury in blue inflicting the second home defeat of the week on leader Stoke City. Ian Stevens scoring 2 second-half goals. The young man who knows where the net is, all right. He was actually born in Malta and would like the chance to play international football for them. The sooner he goes, the better, as far as Stoke are concerned. Consolation goal, a brief glimpse of the form that's put them where they are. Paul Barnes with the big finish. But their main consolation was another defeat for Brentford the night before. Birmingham City inflicted it. Most of their recent problems have been self-inflicted. But Trevor Mathewson, back from suspension, put a smile back on the face of the club with a winning goal after 34 minutes. Brentford's second defeat of the week too. Blackpool without a league defeat since the turn of the year versus Aldershot without a league win since the turn of the year. The difference, a single David Ayres goal after 78 minutes, enough to put Blackpool back on top of the fourth division. The level on points with Mansfield Town, who beat another of the league's poor boys, Northampton, on Tuesday. Wayne Fairclough's adventure rewarded after 15 minutes. Well, almost. He deserved to score himself, but Phil Stant was scavenging under the crossbar. Gary Ford made it 5 wins out of 6 for Mansfield in the second half. Looks like the finish of the Gold Cup, this. Ford coming with a late run on the rails to beat 2 defenders to the line. The message from Northampton and Aldershot is still, please give generously.
Right, but in the second division, Jim, it's really hotting up. I think that's very open.
Wide open, Saint. Uh-huh. You can take two from 8, 10 yeah. maybe. And it is that wide open. I wouldn't put my money on anybody.
No. Right, now time for a break. In part two, we have action from last night and from Scotland. We preview tomorrow's The Match with Manchester City striker David White. And we feature the league's youngest public address announcer. So, don't go away.
With some high-interest accounts, you lose interest on withdrawal and 90 days' notice. But we've made a change, because we don't want to lose you. TSB. We want you to say yes.
The new Volkswagen Golf. Safest Volkswagen ever built. It has a new body that can absorb 36% more shock. Impact bars have been built into the doors. Even the dashboard is reinforced to help protect your legs. In fact, the new Golf is built to exceed the toughest safety test in the world. But it's not only safer for its passengers. It's also safer for the environment. Because the new Golf is designed to be the most recyclable Volkswagen ever built. The new Volkswagen Golf.
Swap your Stuart Pearce for David Batty.
No. Collect ProSec cards and you're collecting the official license cards of the Football League. Brilliant shots and all the facts about your favourite players. 35p for 10.
OK. Gary Lineker for Mark Wright.
You haven't got Gary Lineker.
I have.
Wicked. Famously smooth, Tetley.
Opening an account was quite straightforward.
The small business advisor took me through the things I needed to know.
Then I could really start sorting things out.
Like making sure I'd ordered enough bacon trays and cake boxes.
And after that, all I had to get was the van.
And all the menus printed.
You can always speak to the bank if you have any questions, especially now times are hard.
Of course, business does have its ups, as well as its downs.
But you get by, and nothing beats that sense of achievement.
Well, welcome back. Now, news of Graham Taylor's choice for Barclays Young Eagle of the Month for February, which has been announced this morning. The winner is Nottingham Forest's Roy Keane, and he'll receive his award before today's home game with Norwich City. And I see that Graham Taylor said that last season we were welcoming Roy Keane as an extraordinary young talent. This season he has shown that it was no fluke, Jim.
Well, I think that's fair to say, isn't it? He is now a complete member of the Nottingham Forest team. This was his victory goal and put them in the final. And he's played superbly all year, along with a lot of the other Forest players. Good choice here.
Good choice.
Can't argue with it.
Right, well, last night's action now, and it involved two teams on the fringe of a third division promotion race, Stockport County and Bournemouth. And our old pal was playing,
our
Kevin.
Our old pal Kev was
Kevin
playing.
Francis. But
there's Kev there, chasing. Go on, Kev, my son, get in there. And this was interesting because Kev got brought down, as we all see, and looking a bit injured at the time. But look, the lights went out. And believe it or not, poor old Jim Gannon had to wait 10 minutes. The referee took them off. He had to wait 10 minutes, which must be a long time to take a penalty.
Could you believe sitting in the dressing
room
waiting to take a
penalty?
Oh,
aye, and he takes it.
Ooh,
and he scores. Now, you'd
have
thought the keeper would have taken it after 10 minutes of getting there, wouldn't you? But there you go.
Yeah.
And Stockport continued, and that was another... Oh, dear.
Kevin.
Kev went over again, but fortunately, no penalty. Andy Priest making it 2-0. And in comes our old pal Jim Gannon again to make it 3-0.
They get a lot of goals, Jim, with the old top ones at near post,
yeah,
obviously, with big Kevin being there,
right.
You know, 6'12".
You're quite right, 6'12". They are useful, and here he is, scoring himself with a diving header. And then doing the limbo underneath here. Yes, well done. There you go, my son. Well done, Kev.
Oh, and then he's up again.
He's up again. Go on. And Tony Barras makes it 5. Third in the league, biggest win of the season, Bournemouth 9th, and their worst defeat of the season.
Yeah, very, it's a strange result that for Bournemouth.
Yes.
Right, now we've featured a couple of offbeat stories this season with interesting characters behind the scenes, like the workaholic chairman of Cowdenbeath and the secretary of Aldershot who slept on the floor of his office. Well, Jim Rosenthal has unearthed another character for us, this time at Oxford United.
On the pitch, Oxford United have been forced to throw the kids in at the deep end, and the likes of Joey Beecham are making the most of it, as United have to sell to survive. Beecham gets 2 last Saturday in Oxford's first win over rival Swindon for 10 years. He was 20 yesterday. The youth policy extends to the stand as well.
Some birthday announcements this evening. It's happy birthday to Chaz for the 12th of March. He sits
at the Manor. They reckon they've got the youngest PA announcer in the Barclays League. He's a 15-year-old schoolboy, Jim Henderson, a fifth former at Ulster Grammar School. On midweek match days, getting to the ground on time is Jim's first problem. The school's a good 2 hours away. At 3:35, it's straight on the bus home to Bidford-on-Avon. And half an hour later, it's home James with younger brother Martin.
Hello.
Hi.
All right, yes, fine.
right.
And then upstairs and off with the uniform and on with the yellow shirt. Tonight, it's Watford at the Manor, and that's over 40 miles away. So, just time for a quick drink, courtesy of his mum, Pam. And then Dad John runs him down to the local station. It's the 4:36 to Oxford. And then a couple of miles up the hill to the ground. Finally, Jim's ready to go to work.
Good evening, everybody. A warm welcome to the Manor Ground for tonight's Barclays League Division 2 match between Oxford United.
He's a fan with a mic, really. And there's frustration as John Dernin's denied by David James. Anxiety as the former Oxford man Lee Nogan threatens. But when Kerry Evans fails to convert the best chance, we've seen Oxford's first goalless draw in the league all season.
Thank you all for your support tonight. Tonight's attendance, 5,808.
He wants to broadcast on a much wider stage.
Yes, I'd like to go into sports journalism on the whole, really. And really interested in football, but obviously leave my options open. And hopefully be a good future for me.
And you've also got your own column in the programme, haven't you?
That's right, I write two features, look back and next game. And that came about actually following the work experience when Roy Grant, the programme editor, asked me if I wanted to write a programme, a piece for the programme, because I'd help get the programme ready for the match. And I've done it since then.
Well, it's a long road. Good luck.
Oh, thanks very much, thank you.
Yeah, well done, young Jim. Future ahead of the boy.
Hope so.
And you know, Jim Rosenthal is a fan of Oxford. He's an Oxford boy, Jim, and he sponsors Joey Beecham.
Yes, left sock, I think it is. I think he sponsors. Knowing Jim's general. Actually, it's nice to see. It's nice to see old Rosie back because he's had chicken pox.
Yes, yeah.
He's been quite ill with it. Mm-hmm. He grew a black beard, and at the rugby the other week he was coming down, and as he was walking towards us, we were all going la 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 la, because he looked just like Topo. He did. He's got another career as Rosie.
Oh, good.
This one ain't working, so he might as well try the other one.
Now to Scotland. I mean, must congratulate Airdrie for proving us wrong in our Scottish Cup predictions last week and beating Hibs. Now, Airdrie have 10 Premier League games left to stave off the threat that St Mirren are posing in the relegation battle, a threat that became more real last Saturday with this win for Davy Hayes' side at McDermid Park.
By Paul Wright, finding Dees. Campbell Money committing himself. Penalty kick awarded. Well, Paul Lambert inside his penalty area there. Committing the foul. Well, the chance on here for Paul Wright to score his 17th goal of the season. And he drives it home with plenty of power. McDowell's in there. Oh, what a tremendous header by Kenny McDowell. Played through for Roy Aitken. What a great run there by Aitken. He was picked out brilliantly there.
Right. Big Roy's first goal for St Mirren.
Oh, first goal for... I thought he was going to say first goal ever. First goal for St Mirren.
Second goal ever. But they're doing well, St Mirren, working out. Now, we had the Scotland's under-21 team in action during a week, Jim,
yes.
In the UEFA quarter-finals against Germany.
Doing very well as well.
Well, they did do very well. And scored off this cross here with
Creaney
scoring.
Yeah, good effort. I think the old Germans would have been a bit disappointed with the old
Germany were very confident they would do us in this
Absolutely.
One.
Absolutely. And this is a bad goal, isn't it? Bubble, bubble, in, out, in, out. And Niles Schmeiler gets it in the end.
Well, the second leg of that one is on Tuesday, 24th of March, up in Aberdeen. So go and support the boys there. Now, still with youth football, it was a great disappointment last Saturday to witness the England under-15 schoolboy side sharing a drab 0-0 draw with Holland before a live television audience at Wembley. And all this after that we had featured the wonderful football served up by Nottingham Forest against Spurs, which took them to Wembley for the Rumblers League Cup final in April. Now, by comparison, the schoolboys seem devoid of ideas, and we don't mean to point the finger at this set of boys, but according to John Cartwright, the youth coach at Charlton Athletic, the problem goes much deeper.
The main problem is that we do not have a good development system because there are too many people involved in looking after the boys. We have the Football Association, we have the English Schools Football Association, we have the Football League. They all quarrel, and in the end, it's the youngsters who suffer. The thing is out of control. There's no real overall person or body in charge, and so the whole thing really is a muddle. Practice time has been forsaken for competitive match play, and until we do something about that and reverse that completely, we're going nowhere.
Well, Jim, this is a subject that we intend to return to in the coming weeks, by the way, and perhaps to suggest some positive answers. But the problem's there for all to see, isn't it?
Well, he's got good points, John Cartwright, hasn't he? You couldn't agree more with him.
You see, he was telling the lads off camera, we didn't have time to use it there, that the FA now, when they're giving out the badges at Lillishall, talk about direct play, where you have to score or get a shot and goals off five passes.
Nice.
I mean, what sort of world are we living in where you've got to knock it up five passes before we get a shot at goal?
I don't know. I mean, you know, we have to take it back to the boys of 6, 7 and 8 and start playing the way that we used to play, which was really no competition. Just play amongst yourselves. Have somebody there to guide them. But let people develop their own skills. You can iron out bad habits when you come to the age of 15, 16 and onwards.
Well, you can start talking tactics then, Jim, at 15
yes,
or 16.
Yes, you can. But you start ironing out habits of players when they're that young, of 6, 7 and 8, which people are doing, you're actually knocking out their natural ability as well. And it's a shame that we have to enter this world now of where kids of 7, 8, 9, 10 are being asked to win trophies instead of playing football, which they should really love to play. And I would have no competitive football before the age of 12 anyway, and I think certainly before 10, maybe 7 a-sides.
Well, you actually go along with what I said. Funny enough, I was up in Scottish television's programme, Sporting Questions, on Monday, and this subject came up. I was asked from the audience about this, and I said exactly what you said.
Good.
That I work with youngsters in the summer, and we never play 11-a-side football, Jim. It's always small-sided games, and we cut it. But I got a letter from the Irvine Development Corporation, who are running in the summer for the primary schools a 7-a-side competition endorsed by the SFA. So it looks to me as if perhaps in Scotland they're beginning to see.
It's nice to know you and I agree as well, mate. But it's true, isn't
very
it?
Very true.
That's
Jim.
How the game's got to develop.
Okay, well, we'll also be televising the schoolboy international between England and Italy in June, and hopefully by then things will have improved.
Yeah.
But if you'd like the chance to lead the England team out as a mascot on that day, you should keep an eye out for a competition to be launched in all Tesco stores over the next few weeks. In fact, you might even get a game, Jim.
Well, it's possible, Saint. Right. Now, run round Tesco's.
To the match tomorrow, which features fourth place Manchester City and much improved Southampton. That's at 3:20 on ITV. Now, at Main Road, you're almost guaranteed a goal these days from David White. He scored in City's last 7 home games. And this week, Clive Tilsley went to meet the young man who one day hopes to end up, would you believe, on the scrap heap.
If an opinion poll was taken on the issue of likely goal scorers in tomorrow's live match, one young England candidate would be way ahead of all other parties. No, not Alan Shearer. David White is 5 ahead of Shearer in the First Division scoring list, but he's still behind Shearer in the queue for European Championship places. It's a source of motivation for tomorrow. But then David is always looking to tomorrow. Any young footballer with his head screwed on is looking to provide now for his future. You know the sort of thing, sports shop, wine bar. You won't find too many who want to get their hands dirty, though. If it's true that where there's muck, there's money, the White family business should be thriving. David's involvement with a scrap metal and waste disposal firm is mainly on the management and accounting side. Footballers are not that daft. But at the age of 24, he's already seeing a world beyond the costed lifestyle of the First Division.
A lot of things I've done for you. And, you know, here, these really, I'm seeing in my dad and my brother, they've got to, you know, look after themselves, look after the business, and it doesn't take care of itself, and I've got to learn that, and, you know, other footballers have got to learn that as well, because when you're out of football, then suddenly, you know, you've certainly got to start looking after yourself then.
Last month, White was promoted by the boss, called into Graham Taylor's England squad. He played in the B game against the French, and now he's ready for the big business of a full international cap.
From my knowledge of international football, I think if you've got somebody with pace up front, I think it helps. That's why I said if he improves on the touch and technical side, I think he could be a real threat.
I mean, there are a lot of names being mentioned, young centre-forwards at the moment, and really, David's been away down the list so far.
Yeah. Well, you look at his goal record for a lad who, and even this season, he hasn't played all the games up front, and it's a second to none.
There's nothing wrong with competition, is there? And obviously, I'm new to the centre-forward position, and, you know, whether... my history really as a wide player is going to benefit me or go against me, I don't know, because obviously if he feels that I'm good enough to represent my country at either position, then as a squad player that he might see that as a good benefit, I don't know.
Do you think you're good enough at the moment?
I think I am, yeah.
White's future claims will be furthered by European club experience. It's 13 years since Manchester City's last UEFA Cup tie against Borussia Mönchengladbach. David, a Main Road season ticket holder in his boyhood, remembers those big European nights. Now his goals are spearheading another City assault on Europe. They've been resident in the top four of five virtually all season. Some say that's evidence only of a substandard First Division. But such opinion should be whispered in the vicinity of Main Road tomorrow.
David White, Mex is going on, White doesn't need him.
You know, people say we're in a false position, Sheffield Wednesday in a false position, but, I mean, if there's any such thing as a false position in football, then I don't know what it is. I mean, basically, you're up there on your merits.
The thing with the English First Division, when people say it's not a good one, I mean, there's Liverpool, there's Everton, who have had disappointing by their standards. They'll be trying, Villa will be trying, Sheffield Wednesday will be trying, Tottenham will be trying, Arsenal will be trying. A few the whole sides to beat, and I haven't mentioned Leeds United, Manchester United. So the first division is as strong as ever.
It's a good first division this year, and we're very much part of it.
You really think that, yeah?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, obviously you've been around the first division, seen long enough to be able to judge that.
I mean, it's players change, players come and go, and you know people say the good players aren't there anymore, but the good players are coming through, and the good players are.
On the cards, looks a good game.
Oh, it does.
Some exciting players on both sides. Shearer there and White.
Yeah, Shearer and White. I mean, a good point Peter Reid made is that the lad's got pace, and all international players have to have pace. Yeah. I mean, Gary Lineker's proved that. I think all top strikers have to have pace at international level. And maybe, you know, you don't know. I mean, Alan Shearer's certainly a contender. It'll be good to watch.
Yeah, compare the two lines,
and
yes.
Be able to comparison them.
I think, David, I've seen City a few times this year, and I like what I see. I think they're a very entertaining side. And Big White gets in positions, doesn't always take the chances, but, you know, he has taken enough to be up there among the top goal scorers, so it'll be interesting tomorrow.
We've said this about young players, but, of course, as the season goes on, they develop, and it'll be good to watch tomorrow, I'm sure.
Thank you. Right, now, before we go, I must mention one testimonial next week, and that for Paul Stancliffe, who's now with York City. His game takes place at Bramall Lane, Sheffield, on Monday night, 7:30, Sheffield United against Malmo of Sweden. There's top-class international indoor athletics on ITV this afternoon, the Vauxhall International between Britain and the United States. That's at 2:25. And don't forget the match tomorrow at 3:20, Manchester City against Southampton. We will see you at the same time next Saturday. Bye for now.